Welcome in. It's episode 39 of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. I'm Daron Vaught. Happy to have you with us. And for our guest today on episode 39, one Skip Schumaker, who was a member of the 2006 professional national team for USA Baseball. That's the squad that ultimately qualified Team USA for the Olympics in a Copabe event, ultimately won in Havana, Cuba. Certainly a cool experience. Skip was in his mid-20s and had never represented Team USA in any fashion before. You'll see and learn and hear that he's very thankful for that opportunity, which happened, of course, before being up full-time with the St. Louis Cardinals and being part of a World Series team in 2011, one of the most exciting World Series of my lifetime, for sure. So he and I will talk about that as well. He grew up in Southern California and was a Dodgers fan and had quite the admiration for Oral Hershiser. In fact, he wore number 55 in the big leagues, just as Oral did because of that. And he got to meet him at a relatively young age, which we get into as well. So without further ado, here's episode 39 of Covering the Bases with our guest, Skip Schumaker. So for episode 39 of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball, we welcome in Skip Schumaker, USA Baseball alum, as well as the associate manager for the San Diego Padres now. Skip, what's up, man?
Yeah, no, thanks for having me on. I'm still not quite sure what the associate manager title is. I get questioned about that all the time, but no, I'm excited to be here, and it's actually an exciting time to be a Padre, so I'll take any title there is.
Yeah, no doubt about it, man. It's an exciting team that I personally have enjoyed watching, especially the past couple of years. That was going to be my first question. You've been the first base coach since when, 2017. What changed about your job description from one year to the next prior to 2020?
Yeah, there's a new manager that was hired, Jace Tingler, so every position pretty much is being interviewed when a new manager is hired. Having a relationship with AJ Preller for a number of years and, having that trust with the front office and, a new manager coming in who Jace and I hit it off right away. And he asked if I would be, kind of the bench coach kind of deal, next to him, which associate manager is. And obviously I took that, not even questioning, I didn't question that at all. It's yes, before he got it out after he offered, and I'm just super blessed to be a part of it. I live an hour away. So I don't have to uproot my family. I have two young kids and a wife. And so it was really nice to have them still stay in their own schools and their own friend group and that type of thing, because this lifestyle isn't always easy. As far as that's concerned, being on the road so much. And so being able to still live out my dream and have my kids still be in their friend group was ideal.
Now, I'm curious just from your mindset, not that you're more lax prior to being named associate manager, but did you find yourself just kind of thinking about the job differently than because of that title on a day-to-day basis?
Yeah, I think yes and no. So my career was mostly on the bench. And I say that because I got to watch Tony La Russa do his thing for a number of years. Hall of Fame manager, everybody knows who Tony La Russa is. And he out-prepared the other side. And so before that other manager knew what he was doing, Tony already knew what his move was going to be. So I learned a ton by just watching the game, and that was extremely helpful for me in the role I am in right now. And so I at the time I didn't think being on the bench was the best thing, but now I'm super grateful that I got that opportunity to sit and watch the game, see what moves were made, helping him put what he was doing for guys like me is putting me in a really good spot to succeed, and not put me in a tough matchup or the bullpen guys in a tough matchup. So I got to watch the game in a different view, in a different lens. And that's really helped me, in my job right now.
Would you consider that like the point at which maybe you started to consider a life, a career in coaching once you were done playing, or when did that get on your radar as something you might want to do?
Yeah, it started, because I've a lot of my career was the 25th guy, right? Like I just made it on the team out of spring training. I was the up and down guy early on. I only was an everyday starter, maybe 2 or 3 years of my career. So you always had to have a plan B just in case, right? I had a young family, I had to support them somehow. I didn't have a college education yet. I went to UCSB, but I left after my junior year. So I always had to have something in back of my mind and teaching the game because it was so difficult to me. I learned a lot with a lot of really good coaches around. So giving back and teaching the game was something that I had, a lot of interest in. And luckily I got to do it right away in the big league level.
Last thing, and then we'll move on to your Team USA experience. This is, after all, the USA Baseball podcast. Safe to say you have interest in managing a team someday?
I do. I always say there's nothing like holding your own baby. Right. So, you held someone else's baby and you're like, oh, here you go. You can have it back now. But there's just something, I'm looking forward to the challenge, to see what I can do with that title. I don't know if it's ever going to happen. I really like the role that I'm in now and, where we live and, what I was talking about with my family. But I would love the opportunity to see if I can do it or not. And there's only 30 of those in the world. And there's some really, really good candidates that, I've interviewed a few times and the guys I'm competing against to get those jobs, I think can manage. So I was like, I don't have a bad thing to say about my competitor. So the guys who've gotten the jobs, that were ahead of me, they were well deserved. They deserve to get those jobs. So a lot of good baseball people around. And if I'm fortunate enough to get one, then I'll take it.
You mentioned being the up and down guy a lot, especially early in your career. I think that you would maybe agree with this, that it turned out to be a really good thing in the sense that you ultimately were able to represent Team USA, because it was the 2006 professional team for which you played. And that was the Olympic qualifying tournament that ended in Cuba, but that was the same year as the World Baseball Classic. So it was this weird dynamic with the WBC team and then a team of guys, largely minor leaguers to represent and try to get Team USA to the Olympics. From your perspective, how did that all come about? Because I know, man, I've talked to enough of you guys who did it for long enough that it's an absolute grind when you're sort of on the cusp and up and down and not 100% sure, when a call is going to come. I would imagine the chance to represent your country comes as like a pretty big confidence boost in one of those periods.
Absolutely. So, at the time when I was asked, I wasn't quite sure why I was asked, right? I wasn't that top prospect guy. I was up and down. I was hitting like 180 in the big leagues. And the guys that were asked were Billy Butler and Aiden Hart and Brandon Wood and like dudes. And I was never a dude. I was never on that top prospect list. I just wasn't that guy. And so when the GM called and asked if I would do it, I was just like taken back, first of all, because it was almost like a big league call up for me, just because Team USA it means so much to me. But I was never, so I never made an area code game. I never made any of those showcase teams. And so this was kind of like the first one that I've ever been asked to be on. And to me, the best one there is. And so I was like, I called my agent. I was like, there's these 18, 19, 20 year old kids that are going to be big leaguers for a long time. What do they want from a 24 or 25 year old? This just doesn't make any sense. And I don't know if, Paul Seiler and these guys really knew what they were getting in me, but I think they maybe wanted just that, kind of veteran, mentor kind of deal, with these kids. And, if he plays great, but, I'm not really looking for this guy to maybe produce, but just kind of like corral the guys, you know, culture, chemistry type deal. But for me, I was looking to like, you know, I need to keep proving myself. And so when I got that call, man, I was so excited. You know, I was ready to jump right in. I found out who the staff was. You know, I have three pictures in my room of teams. Two of them are the World Series teams that we won in 06 and 11. And then that Cuba, when we won in Cuba. So that's how meaningful it was for me. And I'll never forget just, you know, being asked that night.
Well, if you would just elaborate on that, what do you remember from it? Was there a lead up to a final decision that you were going to be on the team? Who was ultimately making the call? Did you hear from your agent? Who told you first directly that you were going to be on Team USA?
Yeah, my agent gave me a call, and then I contacted John Mozeliak and Walt Jocketty at the time. And Mozeliak was the assistant GM at the time. He's obviously the GM for the Cardinals now. And I just point blank asked him, I said, you know, I've been up and down. I'm going to be gone 3 or 4 weeks. I'm not exactly sure the timeline. Is this going to affect me getting a call up? Is it going to affect my career path to get back to the big leagues? Because that was, you know, this is the ultimate goal, is to play in the major leagues. But I didn't want to, you know, say no to this opportunity too. But if it was going to make me not go back up in September, then, you know, I'm not sure this is the right way to go. So he assured me that like, this is going to be a really good thing. You get to play, you know, international. And I played winter ball the year before in Venezuela. So I know how beneficial that is for your career and playing in tough environments, playing against, we play against Panama and all these other different teams. And it was so gratifying to see, there's a few different layers to this, I'll go down that road later. But, Mozeliak assured me that this is a good thing for my career, a good path. You'll get a September call up still. Then it freed me up. And I said, okay, now I get to go all in. I get to meet new guys and prospects. And so I was super excited to start that journey.
Did you know that you can own a piece of history? Head to usabaseballshop.com, click on Game Worn under the Gifts and Accessories tab, and find game worn jerseys from your favorite USA Baseball alumni. And our stock is always being updated, so check back regularly for your favorite players. Plus, you can add some cool gear for the spring. It's coming up fast. Remember, free ground shipping also on all orders over $99. It's the Game Worn Collection, and it's only at usabaseballshop.com. You mentioned your sort of struggle with why you were going to be there. Describe walking in to the group for the first time. Did it meet expectations of, okay, I feel like the veteran presence here, or did it look a little bit different in application?
It felt like I was the veteran presence for sure. You know, when I first got my big league call up, I saw John Mabry and Scott Rolen and Jim Edmonds, and that I was starstruck, taken back a little bit. This felt like, I'm not saying it felt like I was Jim Edmonds by any means, but I was the only one there, you know, maybe Chad Allen. I can't remember who else had a little bit of big league time, but I was the only one that had the big league service. So it was almost like that, you know, kind of veteran presence that walked in, like established kind of player. I've been where everybody wants to get to, you know, that type of thing. And I knew a lot of these guys hadn't even played double A yet. You know, and I've, yeah. You know, it was really a gap as far as the age, the talent, there wasn't a gap. It was more like they were much better than I was at being at 19 years old. They were just really good ball players. And what Team USA did a really good job of is they didn't get the prospects that were talented. They got really good people. And so that's why, it was just such a great, fun team because of the character of the guys that they chose to get on that team. And so whoever, you know, recommended me, I'm just super grateful at the time. And I'm not sure who that person was, but it's just, I'll never forget it.
I know you mentioned Nick Adenhart earlier. I was doing some reading up on the team a bit earlier, and I think he was one of those guys who hadn't even played double A yet. So That's crazy to think. And he was probably one of the younger, if not the youngest guys on that team. I mean, it was an interesting group for sure. What was it like working with Davey Johnson at that point, being the team's manager? So, I mean, obviously you're used to sort of being back and forth between manager with the call ups and down and, that sort of thing. But, you know, then it's sort of like this breath of fresh air, right? You get to sort of escape the farm system grind for a few. You're inserted into this prospect laden roster. And I'm sure it's energizing to see, you know, guys like Brandon Wood play and do what they do well. What was it like getting to be on a team that was managed by Davey Johnson, just sort of as an aside, that fun aside thing?
I had Tony La Russa, right, for the last couple of years in big league spring trainings, big league camps, and then finally getting that call up. So I had Tony a little bit, and I put him right by like kind of Tony of that guy that's been around the game for, you know, 100 years. He's won a billion games at the big league level, a champion. And so I just wanted to I needed to learn. I couldn't get enough from these veteran players, managers, whatever it was. And David Johnson was top of my list. I mean, I couldn't wait when I saw who was coaching. It was Rick Eckstein. I mean, there's name after name on there that I could not wait to just give me info. I wanted the info, and Davey would do it. And he had a great presence about him. He did it in a fun, loving way. There's a reason why he was a manager for so long, because he was a player's manager, and he could, you know, put the arm around you. He could punch you in the mouth too when you needed it. But he was so great, and just giving everything, you know, all the knowledge that he had throughout the years and giving it to, you know, all of our young players. I'm not sure, you know, a lot of these 19-year-old kids knew exactly who Davey was. I did, and really embraced like having Davey Johnson as a manager. I think, you know, maybe looking back on it, I'm sure a couple of them have a few regrets, not maybe asking him more questions or, you know, getting, you know, what all Davey was about. But I kind of embraced having Davey Johnson as my manager, and I wanted to get everything I could out of him in that 3 or 4 week period.
You said you had played winter ball in Venezuela the year before, right? So this wasn't your first taste of international competition, or, you know, playing internationally, right? I guess international competition can be viewed a little bit differently. This final was played in Cuba, and it was a packed house. And yeah, both teams had already clinched a playoff berth, but the bragging rights element was there. What do you remember about that? Because like just from Skip, you know, we do the collegiate national team here in the States, of course, under normal circumstances, we didn't get to in the summer of 2020, but there's always an international friendship series. And, you know, it's, sometimes it's here, sometimes it's in Cuba, sometimes it's you know, in Japan, sometimes they're here. And we build it around the 4th of July normally when we do those. So it turns into this massive event, right? And even in a different country, right, it's going to be perceived differently because it's not a big league game or things like that. And, you know, we go to the Durham Bulls Athletic Park, and it's a packed house, and there are fireworks afterward. And it's honestly, usually whenever it's done in that way and we get to host on the 4th, it's like one of my favorite days of the year. But you hear stories about, and you know, Jim Abbott, for instance, has been on this show and told us about the games he pitched in Cuba against Cuba. You just hear stories because it's not that baseball isn't appreciated here, but it's a different type of appreciation there. What do you remember from playing in Cuba?
Yeah. So, I didn't know much about Cuban baseball before this. I knew that there was extreme talent over there. I knew the guys that came over here were extremely talented and really good major leaguers, but I didn't really know the history of Cuban baseball. So, you know, getting over there, you have to realize that, you know, it's just so different. So, I mean, you give a $5 tip to a waitress and they're like tears, you know, they're welling up. I mean, it's just a whole different culture of just people there. And first of all, it was the most beautiful place, you know, I think I've ever been. And if it does actually open up to where you can get there and vacation there, you know, it'd be the, like my number one destination spot. It's like stuck in the 50s, right? So like there's Chevy Bel Airs everywhere. And it's just completely different, obviously, than the United States. But the people there, as far as the baseball concern, it's like they're all in. Like this is everything to them. And, you know, I don't want to say it's like, I think it's when you are trying to get out of a country and noticed on the big league level, some sort of scout, USA, whatever, that carrot that they're dangling is much bigger than the kid that's in where I'm from, Orange County, California, that if, you know, if they don't make it in the big leagues, everything's going to be okay. You know, we can figure out something else. This is it. Their families are depending on them. And every game is so meaningful because their families, kids, are depending. It's just the whole dynamic is completely different. You know, a lot like the Dominican Republican kids we have, you know, in our system that, you know, a lot of people are depending on this kid to make it. Well, it felt a lot like that when we were playing in Cuba, that they are depending. There's so much riding on them to perform. Yeah. And you can just feel it. Like they want it. They want it more than you. And you can tell that they, like when you step on the field, you're looking over, it's like, you know, they don't have the fancy cleats. They don't have the batting gloves that we all have. They have the nice uniforms, but they wanted it more than we did. And that's what I felt like. I'm like, oh boy, like heads up, this is a battle. And then you start seeing the stadium fill up. And then you start seeing like, you know, the band starts playing in left field and like, you know, they got the horns and things rattling. And I'm like, dude, it's starting to get packed. And all of a sudden it feels like a playoff major league game, loud cheering. They wanted to beat the United States more than anybody. Right. I mean, this is their World Series. And so it was on and you could feel the energy, the pressure. Even though we didn't have, you know, none of us had any family there. I mean, it felt like we had to come with our A game and represent our country, represent our family, the whole deal, even though we already got the playoff spot. It was intense, the most intense atmosphere I've ever been in. So every pitch mattered. And I've never been in an atmosphere like that, where every single pitch meant something. And because you could hear the crowd, ball one, you know, they're yelling, strike one, they're yelling. I mean, from first inning on. And, you know, I was a leadoff hitter and, you know, and luckily I got a hit in the first at bat, but man, I was like, I haven't like been that tense and so nervous, since my major league debut. And so I just remember, really, you know, helping me in my career because, you know, I've been through, you know, some really harsh environments, in Venezuela, but nothing was like this, where not one fan in the stands was rooting for you. You know, at least the fans in Venezuela, they were, you know, you were representing their team. There wasn't one person that wanted the USA to win. So it was really cool. And then after the game though, you know, you got to give them cleats, you got to give them batting gloves. And then you start seeing a couple of those guys, you know, they get over, to the United States and they start in the minor leagues and big leagues and that type of thing. So, but my biggest takeaway was they want it more than me and I can't let that happen. You know, that was kind of what I took away.
I skipped over something earlier that I always like to ask, people who have played for Team USA teams. And, I'm also interested in, you talk about that intensity, the come down of you win and you did it. You said you achieved what you set out to at the end of this. If you would, Skip, just compare that to the moment of putting on the uniform for the first time. And you know, maybe you catch a glimpse in a mirror and you just like, USA is across my chest.
Yeah. I mean, again, I wasn't, you know, some of these kids have been in that that kind of showcase kind of travel ball system, area codes. They've played for Team USA. I'm not saying it's less meaningful for them to put on the USA jersey, but they might have done it since they were 15, 16 years old.
Yeah,
I had to wait till 25 and never thinking I was getting this opportunity. So putting on the white jersey with USA across your chest, I mean, yeah, I have a few jerseys hung up in my room. That is the number one jersey I have that is like with a picture of it. It's so meaningful. It gives me chills right now thinking about it, that I got to put that on. I kept the jersey. It's almost like the time you get to put on that first big league Cardinal uniform the first day. It's the same exact feeling like, man, I made it. Like, this is it. I have made it. And for a 25-year-old, probably the oldest guy on the team, it's much different than that 19-year-old that kind of probably went through that system already. So, but nothing like it. And then, you know, winning that championship on their, you know, in that stadium on the field with nobody rooting for you except a couple, you know, camera guys and some trainers and Styler. Other than that, you know, like, you know, you felt like you won the World Series, you know, and it's a feeling that I won't forget. We still talk about it. I'm looking at the picture now. I still have communication with a lot of those guys, you know, text message or, you know, Kurt Suzuki just signed with the Angels. You know, we still talk about, you know, that run, and it was only a 3-week run, and you think it was like a 3-year run. And it's just, the memories I have, I'll take forever.
That's awesome. Speaking of Paul Seiler, our Paul Seiler, he says to specifically ask about the famous bus ride after clinching an Olympic berth.
Yeah. I'm not sure how much I can elaborate on that bus ride. we had a guy named Bobby Hill that kind of, took control of that bus ride, and, it was just, you know, again, you don't have bus. It's always better when you win, first of all, right? Like, that bus ride would be nothing if we didn't win. Number one. Number two, again, I go back to the character of these guys, who these guys hired on the coaching staff and who they got as far as players, made it so special on that bus because they're all high character guys and they were all in it to win it. No one was selfish. Like, they were in it for one reason, and then we won it. And it was a blowout. I mean, it was like not a relief, but like a real celebration that we did something special on Cuban turf. And there might've been some drinking involved, 21 and over guys only, and some cigars involved. Yeah. 18 and over, of course. But, you know, just an absolute blast. And the bus ride was not the highlight. The highlight was winning it, obviously, but number two was probably the bus ride back and then the hotel, the bar probably right after that. But again, I was the 25-year-old, you know, like I could go into that bar. So I was the only one, me and Davey and Paul. Yeah.
Cool. So, okay. So going into the sort of, that was the secondary celebration, the bus ride, you win the whole thing. And then I'm told the party after clinching the berth was something to remember. And again, maybe some details that you might not be able to get into, but what do you remember from that night?
Not much. you just felt like you played with these guys forever, the way that we bonded. It was just a special group. And yeah, I don't know, like, you know, Paul has done a million of these things, and, you know, there's been so many good teams that have run through this, but I can't imagine there was a group that was much, you know, more special than ours as far as how quickly we came together and for one common goal. And then, you know, we played hard, but we could, you know, celebrate hard too. And it was well worth it. During that time in Cuba, there's a lot of stuff off the field that you could get in trouble in or with. And, you know, we had some really responsible guys and guys that, decided that, you know, this was important to us and who you're representing matters. And I think it propelled a lot of guys' careers and just, again, fortunate to be part of the celebration.
That brings up an interesting point that just the sense of And we do it every summer with Team USA's or Teams USA, right? You just sort of you microwave a team, and you know, it's there's always a lot of talent, and it varies as to what degree they click. You just coached and or managed in a season in 2020 where you didn't know when it was going to be time to start the season necessarily. It all started kind of quickly, and then you've got this truncated schedule that is 60 games. What did you find most challenging about those circumstances? And was there anything that maybe paralleled to, you know, hey, look, when I did this with Team USA, it was just a few weeks and we had to get on the same page.
Yeah. I think this year was, you know, unprecedented, right? Like, I don't think anybody was ready for this thing. The challenge was being ready for game one, whenever that was, right? We didn't have a date set. We heard a million different scenarios. But I kind of likened it, and a lot of us kind of likened it to, like, you know, soldiers getting ready for war. And I don't want to say like baseball is anywhere near what they do, right? I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is there's no date to when a war starts, right? Like, that's not what I'm saying. But they're preparing as if, like, in case I go to war, I got it, we're getting ready. So I kind of felt like, you know, we should be ready just in case, because we don't want to get caught off guard. We get caught off guard, we're done. And it's a 60 game season, it's over. And so I feel like the, you know, Team USA was, you know, we got to Florida, we were in, the Astros spring training complex, you know, getting ready, and we were getting ready for Cuba. Like, nobody has been to Cuba. Hostile environment, Castro's there, like, crazy. Right. And, so we're getting ready to go to war, and that's the mindset that you have to have. I'm not saying, but again, any means, like, we are a Marine or any sort of fashion, because that is not even close. But all I'm saying is the preparation to, like, when there's a potential start date, you have to be ready. And so there was some parallels there. But you just here, it was just a great, the protocols and everything else were so different, that, but I will say, if you had one guy go sideways in Cuba, it could ruin it for everybody, right? Anybody. And you have one guy in our clubhouse go sideways, the whole clubhouse is COVID, it ruins it for everybody. So there was definitely some parallels.
Now, to your career and what it did for you personally, individually, getting back to the Cardinals, what did you take out of it with you to, you know, later getting another World Series in 2011? Was it just confidence? Was there something that clicked with you when you were playing with Team USA? I mean, you hit 400 and performed really well in those 9 games. What changed for Skip?
Yeah, a few things. That confidence was number one. That I got to play with the best prospects coming up. These were all going to be big leaguers, and a lot of them became big leaguers. And that I got to play with them, and I performed, you know, at a pretty high level with these guys. So that means, okay, maybe I am, you know, one of these guys. I can be a dude, you know, that I've never been. And then, you know, playing in that atmosphere prepared me for going into Philly in a world, in a, you know, Doc Holliday's on the mound, Chris Carpenter's with us, you know, Philly's just going crazy. It's like, dude, it ain't nothing like Cuba. I can promise you that. You know, so all these playoff games that I went to and fortunate to play in, it was nothing like the Cuban experience. And so it really, really helped me with my nerves and calming down. You're still, like, you know, a little bit nervous. We see Doc Holliday on the mound. I'm not saying that that was the same as Cuba, but I will say that it just, like, the experience helped you the more you go up and, you know, whether it is the major leagues or minor leagues, but the major leagues, and then getting into the playoff atmosphere when it's a packed house, the pressure's on. No one likes you in Philly. I keep bringing up Philly, but ain't nobody liking you there. And I'm playing the outfield and I'm hearing, you wouldn't believe what I'm hearing. But it's just like, dude, I had a band in my ear in left field in Cuba. Like, dude, what you're talking about, we're good. So,
unless you've got a trombone up there, man, like you're not going to phase me.
Exactly right. So I think all of that, all those experiences really, really helped in the biggest stage in the major leagues.
Talk to me about the 2011 World Series. It's one of those series that I remember very distinct things about it. Like the nights, some of the nights that David Freese had were unbelievable. And you know, the walk-off that he hit, I was interning at a TV station in Bristol, Virginia. And I remember exactly where I was standing, and we had just like a little monitor up above one of the desks, and that's where I saw it. That means something, right? Like, it's not every World Series you have moments like that are just ingrained, and you got to play in it, man. Walk me through that. What was that like?
Yeah. So let me take a step back, because us getting into the playoffs was the last day of the season. It was that crazy day. If you remember, like Boston and the Orioles, and like we had to watch the Braves and Philly and the winner of that. And then it was this crazy double play. And we're sitting in Houston watching. We had to win. They had to lose. We see it. Oh my gosh, they lost. That means we get to play Philly. And so like we're celebrating. We finally get in. We're 10 and a half games out in September. Like, there is no chance we are going to get in, right? Like, no way. We had injuries. Adam Wainwright has Tommy John. Like, we're out. And we make this stupid push. We get in. We go to Houston. Last game of the season, we're in. And then we get to face Cliff Lee, Doc Holliday, Rose, Walt, and Hamels. Those are our first four we get to face. Like, oh, you know, congratulations. You get to play Philly and Philly with those four. So, you know, we won there. We get to Milwaukee. We you know, that was a much easier series than the Philly one was. Not saying it was easy, but that, you know, we knew who we were facing because we played Milwaukee so many times that season. You know, we still had to beat Zach Greinke twice, but that was a challenge. But then you stare down the Texas Rangers, you know, like, dude, they are firing on all cylinders. They're rotation's great. They have Neftali Feliz on the mound, who's like the best closer in the game. And so it gets to the ninth inning with Ogando in the eighth. Like, we got to score early because it's over the back end of their bullpen. So then, you know, that, you know, back and forth, all game six happens. You know, we're down to a strike a couple times. You know, Lance Berkman comes through, David Freese comes through, but I'll never forget, because I started that game. And then was double switched in like the seventh, and at the set, like, we had like, for call was not like all these, nobody was in the game at the time, because Tony's making all these moves to try to just get a chance in the ninth inning. And then you see Feliz come in, and we're like, oh, we're, you know, there's no chance. So Tony took a couple of us aside, and he's not going to admit this, but I've said this before. He said, hey, make sure everybody stays out here to thank the fans before everybody goes back in the clubhouse. That's where we were at. And, you know, as much confidence as, you know, David Freese won the MVP the series before. So he was on fire, and he was still carrying over, you know, in the World Series. But again, Neftali was lights out. The ball game was over. And, you know, luckily, you know, I love Nelson Cruz, but luckily Nelson Cruz was, you know, he was playing double play or no doubles depth. I really do believe that he was playing further back, but that ball David Freese hit took off. And people don't realize how hard that ball was actually hit. That was not an easy play. And even if another outfielder, you know, better defensive outfielder was out there, I'm not so sure that play is made. It's a really tough play. But the way it bounced off and everything. But my point is like, Tony La Russa said this, hey, make sure you stay out here. That's where we were at. And you never hear him say stuff like
that. Yeah.
And so when that happened, we were just like, oh my gosh, you know, here we go. And then Josh Hamilton, you know, hits a, it's a home run, and then we're down by two. And then somehow, like, Natalie, I guess, was so bent out of shape that he didn't come back out in the 10th. And then, you know, John Jay and Descalzo and Alan Craig, guys that, you know, people don't, you know, remember. They remember the day David Freese, which they should, but those guys got us back, you know, to the tie ball game. And then all of a sudden David Freese with the walk off. And, it was an unbelievable game, but then you're driving home and you're like, dude, I got game seven tomorrow, right? Like game seven of the World Series. And then it's like, oh my gosh, like this is it. Like game six was awesome. Greatest World Series game, in my opinion, ever. But we got game seven. So game six doesn't mean anything unless we win game seven. And then there was a rain out.
Yep.
it didn't rain, but we rain out, which pushed Chris Carpenter back another day. So he gets to start game seven. And so then the rest is history. So pretty incredible run.
Okay. So that was the feeling the day before, like the realization that you're playing in a game seven. How much carried over? Did it intensify up to the moment of the very first pitch? Was it that tense literally until the game was over?
Yeah, it was intense. I mean, it was really intense, but you know, we had such a good clubhouse. And again, the stuff that we talked about, Team USA, the culture, the character of guys, John Mozeliak did the same thing with us in the clubhouse. And it was just a bunch of guys that were, you know, loose and ready to roll. First inning, I think David Freese hits a double, scores two. That really gets us going. And I think actually, you know, they responded. But anyway, the game seven driving in for me, I'll rewind a little bit, was like, there's a lot of doubts going in your head, right? Like, you know, you can mess this up and be on TV highlights forever. And there's a lot of like stuff that, you know, could really, you know, go sideways. Instead of like you thinking about just this championship ring, you're thinking about, well, there's another route this could go too. And so Lance Berkman, his wife, went home, you know, she had kids and so they're getting to school. So we were staying with each other and then they all obviously came back out for that game, but we were roommates, and just kind of like silence, a lot of silence. And Lance can talk. I mean, he's like one of the greatest personalities of all time. And there's just not much being talked about. I don't think he had as much self-doubt as I did. But there was a lot of self-doubt leading up into that first pitch finally happened. Then, you know, you start, you know, just playing the game.
And I think this would be beneficial. So we've got a lot of young ball players who listen to this podcast, and, I think it would be beneficial for them to hear you talk about that, the moments of self-doubt, the applying pressure to yourself, sometimes most of the time unnecessarily, although it's, you know, sometimes there are literal true hypotheticals that exist in those scenarios. What's the graduation like from, oh man, I could lay out for a ball and miss it and botch a play and ruin it for my team? What's the graduation from that to it's just another ball game, just like any other?
Yeah. So for me, the only way that I could eliminate self-doubt my whole career, high school, college, big league level, and into the game seven was preparation. So it's just like taking a test, right? If you're not prepared, you have self-doubt. Well, the game to me was always the test. And so was I prepared? Did I, you know, was my body, my mind, the whole thing that I eat, right? The whole thing since high school was like the game was the test. So that eliminated my self-doubt was preparation. And if I didn't prepare, if I didn't take the extra ground balls or whatever it was, then I was unsure of myself at second base, or I'd be unsure of myself at the plate if I didn't prepare for that pitcher that night or that type of thing. So I made sure I was always prepared. Game seven is just a different animal, right? Because, you know, unfortunately you watch Bill Buckner and you watch all these things happen and you're like, dude, I could be on a highlight reel the rest of my life. That's a real thing. And not a highlight, by the way. So that is, you know, creeps in your mind. But then you start, you know, preparing like it is just another game. You try to convince yourself it's just another game. It's just another game. And then can you prepare to ease your mind a little bit? And ultimately, that's what, you know, a lot of big leaguers do, is if they prepare, then the game is the game. And if you mess up, you mess up. You can live with it because you prepped. And that's kind of, that really helped me.
Yeah. I want to get into one story I read about. You had a chance encounter when you were 5 years old, I believe, with the late Tommy Lasorda, as well as Oral Hershiser. You met them, I think, at a restaurant, and they both signed your glove. What do you remember about meeting those two?
Yeah, so different times, but separately. So it was I met Oral and Tommy different times, but same age though. So Tommy, I met him outside. It's kind of like not a flea market or anything like that, but it was just like it was a bigger open area where there's restaurants and that type of stuff. And, you know, I waited my turn and, you know, said, you know, hi, Mr. Sorda, you know, whatever. My name is Jared Schumaker. I went by Jared at the time. My mom had a Polaroid camera, took a Polaroid picture and he signed the Polaroid picture, to Jared, a future Dodger, Tommy Lasorda. And, so that, still up on my wall here too. Yeah. So that was obviously really cool because he was like this huge figure. I mean, I was a Dodger fan, grew up in LA. They're winning World Series. Like this was like, they were, you know, so much fun to watch. And, you know, the Gibson, the whole thing, I mean, happened that year. So it was really cool that, you know, Tommy could take his, a little bit of time out because everybody wanted a piece of him at the time. And, you know, he signed it and gracious and had a conversation, the whole deal. And I really took him in Oral, and I'll tell you Oral in a second, but that registered with me throughout my whole life and career. Like, you know, what he did for kids and took time and signed autographs and that whole thing meant something to me, not the autograph seekers, but like the actual kids and wasn't just to sign an autograph and get away. It was like, hey, what's your name? You know, how are you? And Tommy was a, you know, obviously huge personality, and I'll never forget that. And then Oral, I wore 55 in the major leagues because Oral did the same thing to me. I had an Oral Hershiser signed glove. He picked me up. I have that picture too. He picked me up to a future Dodger, Oral Hershiser. And I just couldn't believe what just happened. And so fast forward to 2013, I get traded to the Dodgers. Oral is the play-by-play guy on the radio. He hears the story. He comes out, throws the first pitch to me. I'm number 55. So full circle and just super cool. But I also had a bad experience with a professional. I won't say his name on camera. But that also... I kept that with me too. And, and I let him know about it because he ended up being a coach later on actually. And, you would know him, I'll tell you later, but I'll never forget, what that did too. And so I remember stories like that. So, you know, when kids do ask, I don't just blow them off.
Man. And who would have thought you, as it currently stands, would be the number 5 Dodgers pitcher all time ERA leader. Ahead of Oral.
Yeah. Can you believe that? I mean, yeah.
It's only through 2 innings. He threw over 2,100, but like you're at zeros, man.
how I don't have a statue outside Dodger Stadium is beyond me. You know, it's really one day. Yeah. They call him the Bulldog. I haven't got the nickname yet, but hopefully one day. Yeah. 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 He was great. Good guy. And, obviously still a big part of the Dodger franchise. So, just lucky to meet him, you know, as an adult too, and just tell him how appreciative I was at that moment.
For sure. And obviously I'm sure somebody, again, under normal circumstances, I feel like I have to preface most sentences with that. Under normal circumstances, you see a fair amount of him, or at least have that chance with you guys playing the Dodgers so much. So that's cool. It's cool for you to have that relationship for sure. Skip, I do have one more question about the USA the develops program. When we first started Monday Manager, that was you, right? You did those videos. What about the develops program made you excited for that? Obviously, you know, you're coaching and things now, and it's something that you like to do. How did that come about, and what excited you about it?
Yeah. So, when I first retired in 2016, I got the chance to go help out at the 14U in Cary, you know, kind of on their development. You know, these guys are trying to make a team, and kind of seeing who they were. And they asked me to be a volunteer coach for a week. And I just, you know, kind of fell in love with the staff there and, you know, what they were all about. And so then they asked me, you know, would you be interested in doing the Monday Manager? This is before I got another job with the San Diego Padres as the a special assistant there. And, you know, for me, there's just, I hate to say it, but there's just a ton of bad coaching. There's a ton of bad coaching out there, right? I have a 13-year-old son. We've been through it, and it just like blows my mind what people are teaching. So I thought this would be a really good opportunity, not only to get back, but like, you know, hey, this is the right way to run the bases. This is what the mindset is, you know, at the plate, or, you know, what are you thinking about, you know, when you're in the outfield and, you know, you haven't got a ball in, you know, 12 plays. So, I thought it was a really healthy way to get back and kind of, dummy down for some parents that, you know, might not have, because my dad didn't play baseball. He coached, you know, God bless him, but he didn't know the game. And so it's just, I could really maybe help, you know, these parents that are trying to, you know, be a little league, coach or whatever it is, and help them, you know, kind of teach the game.
Nice. Well, in addition to that, we appreciate all you do for USA Baseball, including the time today to be a guest here on Covering the Bases. Thankful very much that you're a part of the family. That's a forever thing. You know it. And, we'll catch up again soon. All right.
Yeah, thanks for having me on, guys. I really, really appreciate it.
That does it for us here on episode 39 of Covering the Bases, the official podcast of USA Baseball. Thanks for watching. Thanks for listening on whatever platform you choose to do so. And a reminder to rate and review the podcast wherever you do that, if you so choose. It's a big help and would be greatly appreciated. But until next time, so long, and we'll catch you later.